when the stone was rolled away.
Amen.
That was breakthrough. Amen. That was the time when Jesus resurrected from the dead. He died in my place. He died as me. Bible says, before he died, I was in Adam. I had Adam's problem. I had Adam's nature. I was acting like old Adam. I was acting like Adam who had sin nature. I was sold to sin. I was not known to victory. I was being bashed by the power of darkness. But my friend, when he rose again, the stone was rolled away, the breakthrough was sealed.
Amen.
And I tell you, breakthrough is sealed in our lives. All I need to do is to give him permission. That's the only condition. That's the only condition. I am going to give him permission to deal with my situation, to deal with my life, and I will be determined not to dishonor him. I will be determined not to defile myself with the delicacies of the king of this world. Ask me, who is the king of this world? Devil is the king of this world. He took the authority by deception in the Garden of Eden. From that time on, he is running with that authority. That's why Jesus had to become man. And he took the authority not by trickery, as the devil did. He took the authority by giving his own life. Devil wanted to have him shortcut so that he could entangle him in the same way he entangled Adam in the Garden of Eden. But my friend, Jesus will not do anything by his own power. I can tell you, as a man, he was on this earth. If he would not live the life exactly according to the Spirit of God, there was an opportunity for his fall. But he was determined from the very beginning, I am not going to live this life. From the day he was baptized in water, Bible says the Spirit drove him into the wilderness. And from then on, it is written over and over again in the Scripture. And he said it clearly, Son of himself can do nothing. 3.5 years of the life of Christ was a mortal life. Listen very carefully. Some say, I cannot be like Jesus. My friend, he did all these things as a man. Spirit of God came upon him. He was led by the Holy Spirit. He said, I don't speak a word until I hear the Father speaking. He said, I do not do anything until I see my Father doing. Everything he said was heard by the Father. Everything he did, he saw the Father doing. So, that is the key. Christian life cannot be led by any human being. Christ comes in, you are dethroned, he is enthroned, he lives through you. He lives this life. It is his victory, my friend. So when he came out of the tomb, my friend, he declared, all authority in heaven and earth is given unto me. Did he say as a God or as a man? As a man, he lived a mortal life. You say, I can't live a holy life. I tell you, all you need to do is to have the corrected knowledge and corrected thinking. It is not going to be a process. It is an instant thing in the name of Jesus. Because when he comes in and you are willing to surrender, it is done deed. He said, what's the subject of your message today? And that was an introduction. By the way, the subject is very simple. Christian and politic. That's the message today. And my friend, it has been taught, and they take the words of Jesus that he spoke before Herod. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. So the Christians sit down and relax, and they say, well, we're looking for the kingdom that one day will come, and then we will be active. They became passive. They do not do anything. Non-believer in an awkward theology, take the position. They take the position in the offices. They take the position in the council. Now they make decision for them. They make decision for a Christian. Their theology is twisted. Their way of thinking is twisted. Christians are relaxing and they are not getting involved in the affairs of the government. And because they're not involved in the affairs of the government, they just relax because the kingdom of Jesus is not of this world. That is called shallow thinking. That is called awkward way of perceiving things. My friend, as a result, since Christians do not take part in the affairs of the government, their children will be under someone who thinks awkward, who thinks nonsense, who doesn't think according to the Bible. He will impose their opinion upon you. He will oppose their decision upon you. Then this government and this country, the Great Britain, will be sorry that we have been sitting back, relaxing, not giving heed to God. Foreigners are ruling them. Foreigners will rule them. Foreigners will bring their laws. And my friend, their liberty will be gone. If they do not wake up, my friend, and if they do not get involved in the politic, in the government, in the affairs of the government, it is going to be very hard for them to live. It's going to be hard for them to live. What I'm simply saying, Christians should be in the politic, but not like an ordinary man. Not like an ordinary people. You would ask me this question, well, how shall a Christian be in the government? How shall a Christian be in the politic? And my answer is very simple. Exactly like Daniel. That is the example. In these last days, my friend, if you're thinking of liberty, if you're thinking of freedom, if you want to live a free life, I tell you, now is the time to be a politician like Daniel. How do you become a politician like Daniel? The question after question, my friend, how do you become a politician like Daniel? How can you become like Daniel in this in that country, in Iraq, in all this area where Daniel was, Iran and all this? Prime minister would always be the same. Kings were changed. Regimes were changed. After Nebuchadnezzar, Medo-Persian came. After Medo-Persian, he was always the prime minister. In both these governmental affairs, Daniel was prime minister as long as he lived. So my friend, how are we going to take part in the affairs of the government? I would simply say, just like Daniel. Say, can't be like Daniel. Then you're choosing to live in slavery. You're choosing to live under the decision of other people. You're choosing to live under the decision of the foreigner. Foreigner will rule you, my friend. I'm speaking from my heart. Christian got to wake up. God's people got to wake up. in this country, they have to wake up. If they decide to stay passive, if they decide to stay passive, I guarantee you, my friend, they will be in slavery to the foreigner. Foreigner will take the offices of the government. They will impose their decision upon you. You have to live by the rule of the foreigner. Let's go to the passage. How can you become an effective person in the affairs of the government? By the way, what is politics? And one of the definitions of politics was pertaining to or promoting a policy. It is promotion of a policy. If a foreigner is on the throne, if a foreigner is ruling, and he has got different ideology, he's got different perception, different way of thinking, don't you think he will crush your freedom? Don't you think he will destroy your freedom? God's people, this is a Christian country. This country did a lot for the glory of God. This country translated the Bible into a language that everybody could understand. It was not allowed to translate the Bible, but this country gave sacrifices. Tyndale, did he not sacrifice his life? The other men of God, so that you can read the Bible, my friend, this country has ruled the world, hasn't it? Sun was not setting in their kingdom. But the unholy people, no. Majority of them was following Judo-Christian values. Now those values will be taken away from you if you will not wake up and not listen to God. If you will not set your property right, my friend, you've got to live under a foreigner, under the foreign laws, my friend. And when you wake up, it will be too late. I'm simply saying, let's come to the point where we live like Daniel. Daniel was in slavery. Daniel was living under the rule of a tyrant. He was living under the rule of Nebuchadnezzar. He would say, kill him. That was the command. There was no appeal. He was living under a great dictator. And my friend, this is the way he lived. Let's go to Book of Daniel. And listen very carefully, my friend. I'm simply saying, Jesus ruled when he was on this earth. Some people think he was not ruling. Was he not ruling the element? Was he not ruling on the storms? You see, Herod was the king. Oh, let me tell you a story. If Herod was the king, Herod wanted audience of Jesus. In many words, Jesus said to Herod, audience denied. Not worth seeing me. I don't want to be in your presence. Now tell me who was the king here. Tell me who was the king. He wanted to see him. And when he saw him, he didn't get anything out of him. It was at the trial of Jesus. At one point, they tried to frighten Jesus and they told him, run away from this place, because Herod is going to kill you. What did Jesus say? Tell that fox. He didn't call him king. He didn't even call him king because he was the king. He was king over the bodies of the people. He was the king over the atmosphere. He was the king over demon, my friend. He was king over everything. And 3.5 years, he ruled as a man spirit filled should rule. For 3.5 years he ruled like a man who was filled with the Holy Spirit. Jesus ruled. 3.5 years, he ruled even on the crucifixion. Did he not arrange his arrest? Did he not say to Judas after he gave himself, go do what you want to do? Was he arranging his death? Did he arrange everything about his death? Did he not tell the disciple that I am going to go to Jerusalem? I will be arrested. They will take me. They will kill me. I am going to be buried. And third day world, my friend, who was absolutely in control. He was the real king. The other were puppet of Rome, puppet of the people around. They were listening to him. This was the real king. And God's people, if he lives in me, I am going to be conscious of his presence. I am going to come in his presence. I am going to look to this King of Kings. And I'm going to walk with him. And I'm going to stay away from defilement. I'm going to stay away from filth. I'm going to stray away from the delicacies of the king. And I'm going to be what he wants me to be. Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. It's a powerful story. I think it's good to read the book of Daniel. I'm simply saying to you, Jesus ruled as a king. And when he left, he gave you the authority. Only kings have got authority. He said he made you kings and the priests. That's what he said. That's what he said. He made you kings and the priests. Are we operating? Are we under the circumstances? Are we living under the circumstances? Is our body ruling us? Is the people around ruling us? Are our friends ruling us? And is Jesus? Is Jesus ruling? My friend, if he is not ruling, now is the time to give him permission to rule. Now is the time to tell him, thine is the glory, thine is the power. You bought me with your blood. Possess me, Lord. Possess me, Holy Spirit, because I'm your property. If you are possessed by anything else, my friend, anything other than King of Glory, you are not doing well. Got to be possessed by him. Let nothing else possess you. Let nothing else take over you. But Daniel's purpose in his life, that needs a resolve, my friend, to be an effective person in the governmental affairs. You've got to have a resolve. He had a resolve, he purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of king's meat. What is portion of the king's meat? All kind of pornography, all kind of filth, all kind of idea that you get from your friends, all kind of idea that you get from your peers, my friend. Those must go. You look delicate, you look attractive, but my friend, one day, you have to pay for everything. Some people say, eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow you die. I tell you, something is wrong with this phrase. Do you know what is wrong with this phrase? You won't die tomorrow. You will live to reap what you have sown. That's the problem with this phrase. Eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow you die. No, you will not die tomorrow. You are going to sow something with your idea, with your mouth, with your mind, with everything you have, and whatever you have sown, you will reap. And when you reap, it is going to many, many times more than you have sown. It is a sheer foolishness to say, I'm not going to reap. Everything that you sow today, God has set a principle in the universe. You're going to reap tomorrow. I'm going to reap whatever I am sowing. Whatever you sow, you will reap it, my friend. So watch out what you reap. Watch what you watch. Watch carefully what you watch, my friend, on your internet. There's one button. You are one button away from filth. And the devil will open your mind and you will allow all the filth. You know what this filth will do? It will destroy. You will not be like that. You will not be effective. You will live a life like a rotten person. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuch that he might not defile himself. My friend, what I'm simply saying, do not enter into the affairs of the government without this resolve. If you haven't got this resolve that Daniel had, never enter into those things. You've got to enter, my friend, as the scripture says, as a salt. When the salt is not there, why are the things are happening in this country that should not happen? Because there is not salt around. If the salt is not around, corruption will set in. This country will have corruption if the salt does not get involved. If God's people do not get involved, corruption will destroy. Corruption will take away the liberty. Corruption will take away the freedom, my friend. And when you wake up, it will be too late. I'm simply saying to every one of you, everyone who is listening, who has a salt, be operative. Take your authority. Take your position. Stay away from defilement. Walk with the Lord. Sow right things. And save the people around you. And I say something to you, and it's a very powerful statement. Your failure, my failure, causes people to suffer. If you are quiet, you're not purifying yourself. If you're not staying away from defilement, you're simply living for the temple. It's going to be a dangerous situation. And my friend, it will be too late before we wake up. Daniel literally prayed his people out of the land of slavery. It was his prayer. You read Daniel 9. He understood something from the book of Jeremiah. He understood that 70 years are over and the people are still in slavery. He began to pray. My friend, that's one of the weapons we need to use. Pray for the government. Pray for the officer. Pray for those who have been selected. But at the same time, prepare yourself for action in the government. What will happen if Nehemiah will hear the destruction of Jerusalem and will be quiet? Read the book of Nehemiah and you will see as soon as he heard it, he began to cry. He began to pray. He began to fast. He began to take action, my friend. And because he took action, the heavenly realm began to move. My friend, heavenly realm need to be stirred up. And that's going to be by your prayer. The victory is only by the way they won the war in the Gulf. Gulf War, those who saw it, they remember, they cleared the airways first. Once they cleared the airways, nobody could fly, nobody could do anything. 24 hours, and it was a victory. We need to clear the airways. Our fight is not with the flesh and blood. It is with the principality. It is with the power. Do not fight the person who is causing trouble. No, my friend, there's someone behind him or her who is causing trouble. As long as you keep your eyes focused on flesh, you will not have any victory whatsoever. You're beating the wrong tree, the wrong horse. Dead horse. I tell you, Nehemiah got up, went in the presence of God, got what he needed. How? Through prayer. He went back to Jerusalem, built the wall, made a name in the name of Jesus. And my friend, this is exactly what we are going to do. Esther. Suppose Esther will not move. She will be cozy. I've not been called by the king. And if I go risking my life to the king, I'll be dead. If she will love her life, she will be worth it. Her name will not be in the Bible. Esther took her life in her hand. She took action. She heard from Mordecai, that is the symbol of the Holy Spirit. If you stay in this place today and you're quiet, you're passive, you're not actively involved in the governmental affair, you will not be saved. The nation will be destroyed. That was another time Satan wanted to destroy the seed. The seed that will crush his head. He is worried about his head. Devil is worried about his head. And every one of you is going to be a threat to him. Because you have the seed, the word of God, sown in your heart. Since the word of God, the seed is in you, he doesn't like you. And I tell you, he doesn't like his own people. He's fooled them. He's fooled them in believing that they will be in heaven. There is no other way to go to heaven. Because there is no one else who said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. The only one who said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life is Jesus Christ. No one comes. No one means no one. No one comes. Am I telling you, my friend? There's a compromise. Compromise is coming. In the name of peace. And they will say, you are right, I'm right, everybody's right. You don't have to believe in Jesus. And many will be deceived. Now, the enemy of our soul is in touch with the Pentecostal people, with the people who really believe in Jesus. And he's trying to convince them. Let's join together. And do you know what he is doing? Exactly what Satan did. He quoted the Bible to Jesus, did he not? It is written about you that he will send his angel, jump from this pinnacle of the temple, and they will pick you up on the hand so that your feet will not be hurt. Jesus said, get thee behind me, Satan. Get away from him. It's written, do not test the Lord your God. God's people, it is time to be prepared. It is time to stay away from defile. Time is short. Compromise is coming. One world religion is on its way. There will be no chance. There will be no opportunity. Whether the risk of your life to preach the Lord. As long as you are free, be ready. Do something. Serve the Lord. Let's close our eyes. Let's be moved. There is no time to waste. My friend, we have been recruited in the army of God. You have been recruited in the army of God. You are enlisted in the army of the King of Kings. Let's listen to him. Just like Joshua, who listened to the captain of the army of God, and he gave him the battle plan. He will give you the battle plan. Our war is not against flesh and blood, but against principality and against powers. Subtle enemy. Enemy that is invisible, but real. Let's be prepared. Stand in the presence of God. The presence of God is here. The Spirit of the Lord is waiting for your permission to begin to bring order in every area of your lives. Would you let him in? Would you tell him to do so? He is eager to bring the beauty of the King of Kings in your life. He is eager to cleanse you completely. And my friend, it's wonderful that you're already the home fit for the Lord. All we need to do is to stir ourselves up. Choose not to be passive. We will be passive. Foreigner will govern over you. Liberty will be taken away. Foreign laws will be imposed upon you. You've got to rise up and be counted. Walk in his victory. Lift up your hand to the Lord. Let's say this together. Lord Jesus, we thank you that You spoke about yourself. All authority in heaven and earth is given unto me. Lord Jesus, with the same breath, you told your disciples, and we are your disciples. And you told us clear, go and preach the gospel. And Lord, it's so wonderful to know that you have promised, behold, I'm with you till the end of the age. Father, we thank you. We can enter into the end of the age with no fear whatsoever. In the name of Jesus. Amen.